Hey, this is SG Goodman, and you're listening to Walking the Floor.
I'm walking the floor over you.
Walking the floor.
I'm walking the floor.
Walking the floor over you.
Hola, señores and señoritas. This is Chris Shiplett, and you are listening to episode number 174 of America's favorite podcast, Walking the Floor. Now, I don't know about you where you live, but my kids started school this week, so summer is officially over, but you'd never know it by how hot my studio is, man. Goddamn, I got no air conditioning in here, and I'm sweating like a pig trying to get this here podcast done. What's going on this week? We got the Republican National Convention. That's fucking crazy. And last week we had the Democratic National Convention. That was, also fucking crazy by my measure. A different kind of crazy, but crazy nonetheless. Then we have this horrible, horrible shooting, police shooting of Jacob Blake out in Wisconsin. And all the rioting that's kicked off since. And, I mean, it's just a head-scratcher, like... If you are a policeman in this day and age, with all the recent events that have gone on, wouldn't you just assume that almost everything you do, especially if like you're trying to apprehend somebody or trying to arrest somebody, wouldn't you just assume that everything you do is going to be videotaped and on display for the entire world to see? And you would think, or I would think, that you would assume that. And then doesn't it follow that you would then have some self-awareness to not shoot an unarmed man 7 times like that? I mean, it's just... I mean, I don't even know what to make of it. I mean, I just don't understand police culture in America in 2020. I just don't get it. Head scratcher. Okay, on that uplifting note, let's pay some bills. Zounds.com. How about them Zounds.com? People over there. Did you know that at Zounds.com you get free shipping on every single order with no exceptions, no exclusions? Even if you're going to order something crazy heavy like tube amps or giant synth boards or whatever it is, it still ships free. And Zounds has like 3 warehouses strategically located all over the United States to get you your gear faster than anybody else. That's right, Zounds.com. Okay, let's get to today's interview.
Oh, sharecropper daughter, she sings the blues of a coal miner's son.
All right, S.G. Goodman. S.G. Goodman is a singer-songwriter that hails from Murray, Kentucky, and is a young up-and-comer, putting out her first record in this crazy pandemic where you can't go out and tour, and we talk about all that sort of stuff and what that experience has been like. She has an album out recently out called Old Time Feeling, produced by none other than Jim James of My Morning Jacket. And here's a walk in the floor fun fact about Jim James. You know, I thought I was supposed to interview him a few years ago. Turns out I found out right before the interview I'm not interviewing Jim James that day. I'm interviewing Jim Brewer, comedian Jim Brewer, which was a great freaking interview, but a very different type of interview to prepare for. So one of these days, I got to get Jim James on the show. Anyhow, that's really neither here nor there as far as anything relates to S.G. Goodman, who is on Walking the Floor now.
Will you try hard to comprehend?
All right. Well, so you just put out your debut record, Old Time Feeling. Can you tell me? I mean, like literally just put it out like last week or whatever. But
yeah.
Can you tell me about the great thrill it must be to put out your debut record in the middle of a global pandemic when you can't go out and tour and promote it? I mean, I have to assume, like, you know, things were, like, building probably, like, hey, yeah, I got a record deal. I got fucking Jim James from My Morning Jacket producing it. Like, things are on the up and up. And then, boom, coronavirus.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, somewhere between optimism and a punch in the gut, maybe that would describe it. But I try to think that things are, you know, supposed to happen how they happen for the most part. And just trying to, you know, be optimistic about some you know, positive aspects about putting a record out during the pandemic, which is people are still and they're listening to new music more than ever, you know, and actually listening to the words. So I think that, you know, if I can focus on that, then I'm not paying attention to the fact that I may not be able to tour for a year from now, you know.
Right. Have you done a lot of touring in the past? I mean, are you, I'm not super familiar with your backstory, sort of what you've been up to before this. So are you normally out on the road a lot?
Somewhat, you know, this would have been really the first year that we could claim that we were road worn, you know, compared to national touring acts. Like I've never toured the West Coast, you know, and that kind of thing. So, I feel like we were this close, you know. It was like right before everything hit, we had a tour lined up. I was going to play my first international show in Canada. Mm. But, you know, if it saves people's lives for music not to, you know, pull people into public spaces, then I'm okay with that.
Well, so what are you doing to keep busy while we're all on pause?
You know, I just mow my yard like daily, and you know, no.
So you heard it here first. I'm going to encourage the people to just go by your house. Maybe you'll sing a little while you're mowing. You know, from a safe distance, they can just kind of check it out that way.
Yep, it's just, you know, yeah, it's. So I live in a Western Kentucky town called Murray, and it's right near like a lake. So I've been trying to get out there more than I ever have. And I'm really fortunate. A lot of friends of mine, people who work at my label, they're cooped up in small apartments in big cities. So I've just tried to walk outside every day and remind myself how fortunate I am to, you know, have a back porch.
Yeah.
Things like that. So that, and you know, I will say this, I learned how to stream things online. Like I don't have a TV, so I don't, like, if someone was telling me names of certain celebrities or shows, I have no idea. Basically like the worst trivia partner you could ever ask for. But so I've been taking the time and, like, you know, I'm over it now. I did it for about a month. I would watch a show at night, but yeah, so I've done a little of that, made a lot of home cooked meals, and just tried to, you know, take care of myself, honestly.
That's funny. There have actually been a few moments in this whole thing where I have, like, literally run out of shows to binge watch, where you're like, well, now what do I do?
Yeah, exactly. I watched a couple of shows and I felt the same way. But you know, I've also been trying to read as much as I can, which is really, it's been nice. But I mean,
what are you reading?
Let's see. Well, I was reading Simone Weil's Roots. She's a, like, kind of a, I guess she's considered a philosopher. So I was trying to get into that a little bit more, and just kind of picking up random books around my house and seeing if anything strikes me. I really like short stories. Mm. So, I read a lot of short stories, but I have a Norton's anthology in my house. So I would just pick a short story every day and try to get through that, or, you know, but time just was, I mean, I don't know, maybe you felt this way too. It's like at the beginning, the first few months, it seemed like everything was going so slow. And then once it warmed up, I feel like, oh my gosh, it's going to be Christmas next week. You know?
Right. Yeah.
It's so odd how time has kind of passed in this, but
yeah, it's interesting. I mean, I feel like the first few months while my kids were still in school and doing online school, I had like this burst of organization and work and writing and just doing a lot and being very motivated. And then kind of right as my kids were getting into summertime, I just lost all of it. Let's just go to the beach and I don't know. I really don't feel like doing much of anything anymore.
Yeah. I can't imagine. I mean, you know, I don't have kids. I have a dog and a cat, but I can't imagine the weight of like being a parent and all this. You know, good on you, but whoa.
That's, I mean, you realize how much, how much the rest of the world sort of keeps your kids busy when all of a sudden that's all removed, when they don't have friends, when not that they don't have friends, but when they can't go see friends, when they're not going to school, when all of a sudden you're all in your house all the time, you're like, fuck, how do I keep my kids moving? Like, that's been the interesting challenge. It's also been maybe one of the biggest upsides of this whole thing for me. Cause like I've been working my whole adult life. I've never had a break. So I'm trying to, like, I've really, once it became apparent that this was going to be a long-term thing, I just kind of flicked that switch and just accepted it. And it's been a good thing in that sense, you know?
I feel like I've heard a lot of people who are parents talk about that. You know, there's so many jobs in the world that keep parents from really getting to spend a lot of quality time with their kids. So I think for a lot of people, it's been a positive thing for sure.
Well, so give me like the sort of the This Is Your Life, S.G. Goodman, Cliff Notes, where'd you grow up? What got you into music, family life, et cetera? Like where do you come from?
Okay. Well, I was born in Tennessee, and my parents live in a little town that's right on the state line in the most western tip of Kentucky. It's called Hickman, Kentucky, in Fulton County, and that's right on the Mississippi River. So I was born into a farming family. Mm-hmm. So, long history of farmers there. And I grew up in a town that has less than 3,000 people in it, which means we don't have a stoplight. We have one convenience store, and your closest, you know, Walmart is a 15-minute drive. So, I know there's, you know, definitely a few people who share that experience, but I'm finding out more and more that was kind of an odd, you know, place to grow up and figure out who you were. And I think, you know, like a lot of people who grow up in really small towns, the church is a real community gathering place. It's, you know, what you have to do. And so I was raised in church. I'm a recovering Southern Baptist. You know, I get questions a lot about my musical influence and what kind of inspired me to sing and things. And I tell people pretty quickly, well, my first concerts I ever went to growing up were, bless you. sorry, that's my manager just sneezing in the background. But
hopefully into a face mask.
Absolutely. He's definitely masked up. But you know, I went to church 3 times a week, and that was my first experience with music. And as soon as someone figured out that I could carry a tune, I was kind of guilt tripped into singing, because, you know, they would say things like, well, if you're not using your talents for the Lord, then, you know, you're going to lose them, or, you know, that kind of stuff. But it was a great way to learn a lot of traditional melodies and vocal styles. You know, it's just like when I hear the soundtrack to like, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou or something, or, you know, it's just like, I was raised with those people.
I mean, that's interesting. Cause I wanted to ask you about that. Like if growing up in rural Kentucky nowadays, did you grow up with a sense of the bluegrass musical sort of history and legacy of that part of the world?
Absolutely. It's definitely present there, for sure. You know, I don't, people in my family can sing, and everyone that I grew up with had a piano in the house, but it wasn't like an overly musical family. It was a pastime for them, you know, before I was born, really. So everybody had pianos. As far as bluegrass influence, there's definitely a lot of notable artists from my area, but that wasn't really my biggest influence, honestly. Mm-mm.
Is the musical influence from church, although obviously a heavy influence on a lot of classic bluegrass, is that sort of are those two worlds kind of at odds with each other?
Well, it depends on what church you would go to, because in my church, you know, it was very controversial when I learned how to play the guitar at 14. I was kind of only allowed to bring that out when it was involved in a youth service. Mm. So they were kind of strict about having too much instrumentation going on in a service. I mean, the church I went to was so conservative, you know, they didn't really, if there was a man who could play the instruments, then that was who got to play them.
Really?
Absolutely. If they didn't really want to add any instruments into the service because they didn't want people overtaken by emotion. You know, it's just like a lot of
emotion
people,
is a dangerous influence.
Yeah, absolutely. It's like, oh, okay, so just stand in front of everyone and just yell at them that they're going to hell, but we won't get emotional. You know, it's like, you know, kind of ridiculous. But I understand a lot of people don't have that experience, and that's kind of like, what are you talking about?
But well, it's interesting because I've been doing this podcast for a few years now, and I've interviewed so many people that have come up through the various strains of country music. That have basically told me the same story, that their first musical influence was the church. And as somebody that, like, I grew up, like, my parents didn't go to church. I didn't have any understanding of that culture. So I feel like it's an influence that I just completely missed.
Mm-hmm.
But it informs so much of the music that I hold dear. You know what I mean? So it's something I'm always kind of fascinated about, because I just don't really know. I have no firsthand experience of it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. No, I think it is kind of a mysterious world for a lot of people, and for some people like me, it's kind of a world that I appreciate and I'm thankful for, but I'm definitely like, have stepped away, you know.
Right. Well, when did you go from singing in church to singing, like, you know, at your local bar or whatever, you know, wherever you got your start performing? Mm-hmm.
Well, I did. I kind of started out in pop music around age 18, and my first show ever with a band was, we drove up. I think when I really started taking music seriously and started giving, you know, making more opportunities for myself to play live, was when I moved to college to the town I live in now, which is Murray, Kentucky. And there was a real thriving post-punk scene there. And of course, the music I make in no way goes along with that, hardly. I have influences, but luckily it's such a small place that people really are supportive of whoever's putting themselves out there.
Right.
So, I've just been lucky enough to, you know, really get into that college scene, playing kitchens and all the little bars locally, and that's really where I cut my teeth.
Yeah, well, it's mm-hmm. interesting, you know, in your bio there was a couple of people listed as influence of yours that I thought were really interesting. One being Karen Dalton, who I literally only heard of and found out when I interviewed Molly Tuttle last week. I'd never heard of her, and she's really like an interesting artist from what I've listened to, around online. And but the other one that I was kind of like, what, was Link Wray. I haven't seen anybody list Link Wray as an influence, maybe ever, in anybody I've interviewed. And it made me realize, like, of course I know Rumble, and I know, but then the only other stuff that he did that I'm really super familiar with is like those two records he did with Robert Gordon in the late 70s. But I'm wondering, tell me about Link Wray as an influence.
Well, it's interesting you bring up those songs and those records, because the most influential record for me was a self-titled one from 1971.
Wow.
And it has his face on it. For those of you listening, you should check it out. He recorded that song with his brothers in a a makeshift studio that was once a chicken coop. And I think it was a 3-track recorder that they did. So, you know, I have obsessive compulsive disorder. So sometimes I will get really stuck on one album and listen to it. And I'm not exaggerating, for a straight series of like 3 years.
Really?
And so I could probably.
You're like the music fan that everybody dreams of having.
Maybe, but it's not like I was listening to, 20 other albums at that time. Like
right,
literally
right.
Maybe 3 other albums that I'd probably also been stuck on for years. Like, I think I listened to Chad Van Galen's album Diaper Island for probably 4 or 5 years.
Just
I love
that
album.
Right.
Almost, not really. I mean, I'm listening to other things, but like if I'm in the car, like that's what I will put on.
Right.
And so when it comes to Link Ray's album, if we were sitting in the same room, we could probably have a contest to see if I could hum out every bass line. Like that's how, my mind goes to like, okay, well, how was this recorded? And then actually during making the album, a friend and engineer, Kevin Ratterman, was telling me, he said, how they got that guitar tone? They actually mic'd the window pane.
Hmm.
And like, all these little interesting, or they didn't have a drum set in the house. So Fire and Brimstone, which is a track I would encourage anybody to look up. All the percussion is just on random things in the studio. They didn't have a drum set yet.
No,
it's really,
not.
It's really wild.
And so did you ape some of that in the making of your record?
Maybe. I mean, we did maybe one really interesting drum groove in that record on If It Ain't With Me, Babe. But I love, my guitarist, Matt Rowan, he's really great with, we like to keep things a little dirty as far as tones and, having room noise. And I always like it. Like I play a big hollow body guild, and I like to strum behind, the bridge and things, and just kind of have those like tingy bell sounds that
those
you can
overtones.
Make with your guitar,
yeah.
Stuff like that. But I'm not sure if I ever really evoked Link Ray in this album. Maybe so. People have
maybe
said
in,
it
in spirit.
Maybe so, but I'm just so weird about that because I just, I revere him.
Right.
So it's like, I don't know. But yeah, I mean, believe me, I definitely, that's the album I was listening to when I made this record. So I'm sure there's some link, but I can't pinpoint it.
Right. Sure. Of course. So, mm-hmm. so how did you wind up hooking up with Jim James?
So I found out while working on a project called the Pine Mountain Sessions, which was a project spearheaded by a mutual friend of ours, another Kentucky artist named Daniel Martin Moore. And we went into Harlan County, Kentucky, which a lot of people recognize that name. There's been a lot
sure.
of songs and some documentaries and things come out about it. But we went to the Pine Mountain Settlement School, which was there in Harlan, and recorded some tracks in a 100-year-old church to benefit the Pine Mountain Settlement the Pine Mountain Settlement School. And also
what is the Pine Mountain Settlement School?
So it was formed for the mountain kids to kind of come there and learn vocational skills and have a good education. It was really a way to make sure that the kids in that area were able, from the coal mines and stuff, were able to get an education.
Mm.
And they still have a lot of like educational opportunities for people in the area. It's just such a beautiful campus. It's right there on Pound Mountain, and it's a real special place. But also that compilation, which, there's a lot of notable Kentucky names on there. We have Silas House, Bell Hooks, Wendell Berry, Joan Shelley and Jim James, which is what I'm trying to circle back around to. So I found out that Jim was also a contributor to that, and it kind of set the wheels in motion. I didn't mention it to Daniel at the time because I knew I needed to have my ducks in a row before I kind of told him my dream. But I was searching for an all-Kentucky team as best as I could to kind of bring this album to life. And, you know, kind of what better Kentuckian could you ask for than Jim James to produce your record? So I went home, I made 5 demos, got the nerve up to email Daniel and said, here are 5 demos. Would you be willing to send these over to Jim? And he did.
Did you already have an album's worth of material, or did you write specifically for the record, or like how'd the songs come together for it? Or did you write with Jim, or like how did it all?
No. So what happened was, I definitely had an album's worth of material before I recorded even those 5 demos, but I wanted to make 5 demos to show him kind of the, the varying aspects of what I'm doing. You know, there's like the song Redbird Morning, which was actually the first song and only song he heard of mine at first. It's not really a true representation of my style completely, you know? So, I didn't write with him. And I, one song on the record, Tender Kind, I actually wrote in the studio. But as far as how me and Jim worked together, he was working on promoting a solo project of his under his own name. So he wasn't really, with touring, wasn't really able to be, we knew going in that he wouldn't be in the studio with me. So we did pre-production remotely for the album. So I had a good game plan going in, but, you know, I had to be the Phyllis Spector behind the board and, you know, try to walk that line.
Right.
Steering the ship.
Interesting. Like, so were you the taskmaster in the studio? Cause that's always sort of, you know, that's the good thing about having a producer that you trust is like, when you, at least for me, when I'm recording, I, you know, you get in the middle of a track and these things start to get a little foggy. It's nice to have somebody go like, you're overthinking it. Just fucking simplify that shit or whatever, you know, the case may be.
Yeah.
Did that responsibility kind of fall to you in the end?
It did. I mean, you know, the engineer I worked with, Kate Haldrop, she definitely stepped up and helped, you know, keep us in line because, I mean, you've been in the studio, you know how, even if it's not a stressful situation, it can be really draining just putting that much effort into something. So we tried to make a list of things that we wanted to accomplish that day and be really systematic about it. But I called in a buddy to help be a utility man. So, I mean, I did definitely track my own guitars and stuff on the record. But for a lot of it, I did my best to either just put my part down first or even have one of my bandmates say, like, I'm going to need you to do this so I can direct from behind the board for a minute, you know?
I mean, I'm curious about the, just sort of the overall music scene in Kentucky. Like, it seems like in Americana and country music that right now you have like Sturgill Simpson and Tyler Childers and of course My Morning Jacket, and you could even throw like Chris Stapleton into that. Like, is there a scene there? Like, do you get that, you know, like, is there a vibrant music scene happening that all these folks are kind of coming out of?
I mean,
or is it all like random and everybody's in a different place and not really together? You know what I mean?
I think that's my understanding of it. You know, it's like, you know, pockets of subculture here and there, you know?
Right.
And that's, I mean, I really, you know, I've never met I've out of those, all the people you just listed, I've only met Jim. So right. I don't really know a lot about their backstories or whatever. You know, I know we have Kentucky as a linking, you know, factor there, but I don't really know the scenes that they grew up in or anything. But yeah, I would say it's just, you know, there definitely is a lot of bluegrass. There's a lot of the stuff they call new grass.
Right.
There's a lot of bands like that around and stuff.
That's cleaned up modern bluegrass type of thing?
It's like a mix between like a jam band and bluegrass. I don't know. It's not really, I mean, I've definitely been privileged enough to play with a lot of really strong acts from that, but it's not a genre that I'm super immersed in.
Right.
But you know, yeah, so it's, I would say out of all those, I mean, even though my music, you know, definitely gets categorized or lumped into the Americana vein, I mean, if I was going to talk about like notable Kentucky acts, friends of mine, Wombo, they're this kind of, I mean, forgive me, Wombo, if you hear this, but I would consider them post-punk. And then I don't know what genre I would place this group of people in, but State Champion, they're out of Louisville, and those are people who like come through my town and play at this independent record store, and we've just built relationships over the years. So I'm more familiar with the post-punk scene in Kentucky than I am probably my own genre.
You know, it's interesting, a lot of your songs have like a kind of a left-wing populist slant lyrically, which I love. As somebody who grew up in small town Kentucky, why do you think, especially when you consider that the roots of populism were like radical Midwestern farmers, you know, way back when in the 1890s, mm-hmm. Why do you think rural populations, or what's your take on why they've turned to a more right-wing populist political belief in modern times?
Well, one, I think algorithms when it comes to the internet has had a large part to do with that, with the propaganda that people are witnessing every day. You know, I feel, especially when thinking back to the 2016 election, I had a lot of friends who were like, there's no way Trump's going to win. And I'm like, at the time I was a landscaper. So I ran a weed eater for 12 hours a day. And I was like, you know, Murray, where I live, is a college town, so it's a very tiny blue dot and everything else around it is red. And I said, well, you should take a drive out in the county. And so I feel like a lot of people, as cost of living have gone up, as workers' rights have been stripped, you know, Kentucky in recent years has become a right to work state. I think people have been susceptible when a politician tells them, hey, I see you and you should be making more money. And yeah, they should. But at the same time, you know, we have such regressive policies that are under a lot of policies that rural people typically vote for, such as, you know, banning or restrictions on abortion or, you know, LGBTQ rights or things like that. You know, it's, I feel like I honestly really blame that. I mean, it's very complicated, these things we're talking about, but I feel like as long as a politician puts, I'm pro-life and I'm, you know, pro sanctity of marriage, then people aren't going to read any further because that's appealing to something that's so deep in them, and they would rather make sure they're voting to remain in what they consider like voting as a Christian, which that's, you know, than to read further and be like, oh, this guy's going to make sure that you know, can't be in your union or whatever. Like, so it's frustrating. It's very complicated. You know, but I think writing off the South and rural places for its, you know, regressive policies is not really helping the matter when there's so many progressives who are working daily to try to wake people up to that.
Well, it's interesting, you know, you mentioned that Harlan County, USA documentary, which was made in like the early 70s or whatever, that I actually just watched for the first time recently.
So good. Really,
it just blew my mind.
It's amazing.
Like, to see in the early 70s in these small town Kentucky, these labor organizers who were like so deeply steeped in labor history and so the radical end of you know the pro union stuff. I mean, is there any of that spirit left now? I mean, you mentioned like Kentucky being a right to work state, and that being that's obviously a trend all through the South. Is that like do coal miners support it being a right to work state that's directly at odds with the sort of history of the struggle that they're in?
You know, I feel like there's been some things happen in recent years. You know, Mitch McConnell is my senator and our Senate majority leader. He hails himself as a friend to coal. And, you know, I really hope, especially when it comes to this November, when he's up for reelection, that coal miners will, you know, think back to days of old and really dissect the time frame in which Mitch McConnell works on their behalf, because I would make the argument that it typically coincides with his reelection. So one thing, I don't know, you probably saw this in the news, possibly, where I think it was the Black Diamond coal mines, they went bankrupt. And so when a company goes bankrupt, people's pensions are on the line. So I hope those, you can read about this, but a group of Kentuckians went to Washington, D.C. and tried to have a meeting with Mitch McConnell. And, you know, these are the people who put him into office. Wow. And he met with them for 2 minutes and told them he was holding up the bill, and he did. Oddly, I would say that there is a link between him seeing that Kentuckians voted in a blue governor last year who won with less than 7,000 votes in the popular vote, you know? So I don't know. It's so complicated. You know, I'm not from coal country. I feel like there's a lot of similarities between all businesses and workers' rights. But, you know, I feel like people are starting to wake up, and we've had nearly 4 years, and with Mitch McConnell, he's been my senator before I was born.
Right.
You know, I really hope that people start asking themselves hard questions. And in the words of, Florence Reese, who you heard her sing in that Harlan County, USA documentary, you know, I hope people start asking, which side are you on? You know,
right. So, well, it's mm-hmm. interesting, you know, when you look at that documentary. I mean, like I said, that's the early, like, I think it was shot in 72 or something, which is, you know, it's a long time ago, kind of, but like historically, it's really not that long ago, you know,
yeah.
And it's mm-hmm. such a dramatic, like, I have to assume if you went back and interviewed a lot of those people now or their offspring, they're probably solidly, you know, Trumpian. But I'm wondering is, and I know you did that song, We Don't Want You, Mitch McConnell. And we can get into what, you can tell me about whether or not you've gotten any feedback from the McConnell campaign on that. But, but I'm wondering, in watching from afar, the primary between Booker and McGrath that McGrath ultimately won, I was thinking, you know, while that was going on, like, well, that's interesting. You know, you've got the sort of progressive Democrat versus the establishment choice Democrat, and that's a fight that I'm always, you know, kind of fascinated by and immersed in. But I thought, ultimately, they're just fighting for who's going to lose to Mitch McConnell, you know? And then I looked mm-hmm. I looked actually this morning at some polling that shows that McGrath is actually, like, you know, in a real race there. Do you think that's like, is it possible, is the political trend in Kentucky changing to the extent that Mitch McConnell is seriously in an election fight right now?
You know, so I worked for Andy Beshear through ruralorganizing.org. It was an initiative to put some boots on the ground and canvass across the state of Kentucky. I called thousands of Kentuckians and placed thousands of yard signs for Andy Beshear when he was running against our then governor, Matt Bevin, who is a real piece of shit. And, you know, like I said, in some of the counties or the precincts that we worked in, that have traditionally for the past 15 years or more have voted red, we might have won. We won by like barely a 3% margin or something. So I have, I'm sitting here to tell anybody, I think this election is hopeful. Yes, we might only win against Mitch McConnell by a few thousand votes, but it's possible. And, you know, I think this is something, you know, I will say this until I'm blue in the face. Mitch McConnell being in office and serving as the Senate Majority Leader is not just a Kentucky problem. He affects you wherever you are today. You know, we're going into the talks of extending the CARES Act in some way. This is going to be very detrimental, once again, for workers' rights if he passes it to where institutions and corporations are not liable for the safety and well-being of their workers. How long is that going to last after the pandemic is over? Will that shift workers' rights forever? We don't know. So I encourage anybody who's listening to get on board with the Amy McGrath. You know, I understand, you know, I'm a progressive and would love to have thrown my full support behind Charles Booker. But this is not something we can mess around with. Andy Beshear wasn't my type of Democrat either, but I worked for him and he's saving lives right now. So I'm thankful.
Well, I agree with you on that, that, you know, for all the hysteria around Trump by a lot of my Democratic leaning friends, and as bad as Trump is and offensive on many levels, I mean, I think it's Mitch McConnell is the one actually whispering in his ear, and you know, I don't think Donald Trump's coming up with any of these policies on his own. It's really the Republican Party, you know, using him to push through the most sort of radical ends of
legislative priorities.
So yeah, mm-hmm. I agree with you that the guy's got to go. It's just, I never thought I'd see the day.
Yeah. Well, they have the best opportunity to do whatever they want without being, you know, under the eye of the American people, because luckily for Mitch McConnell, he gets to have, you know, he knows that the American people are watching a circus every day.
Right.
So it's like right now, you know, he's put in around or over 200 federal judges.
Yeah.
I mean, that's going to have long.
Decades.
I will die before we are over the consequences of Mitch McConnell.
Sure.
But, you know, if you care about the fires in the rainforest, I mean, this is how wide stretching the consequences of Mitch McConnell and who he's connected with in the world. One of his biggest donors is the Blackstone Group. You can go to his campaign finance and you can see this, you know, they're the company that are getting the finger pointed at for like setting the rain, you know, having fires in the rainforest. Also, my father, like I said, is a farmer, you know, so he's experienced the tariffs, you know, consequences from the tariffs on China. At the same time, when our government was telling farmers they were making a sacrifice to stand up to foreign interests, a Brazilian company like the Blackstone Group received over $6 million of American taxpayer money through the farmer's bailout. So that's just things that I feel like people need to become aware of and realize that, you know, him being in office, he's the hands and feet of this administration or the locked door to the next, and we have to get him out.
Well, there you go. We have set ourselves up for some really wonderful pushback on our respective Twitter feeds, and that'll be fun.
Yeah.
Hey, thank you so much for doing this today. I really appreciate it. I really look forward to someday when the world turns back on, actually getting to see you play live. I think your record's fantastic. And
thank you so much.
I like your songs a lot. I like your voice, and I like what you're doing. So good luck with it.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. You stay safe, and yeah, once again, give some money to Amy McGrath, you know.
All right. I'm going to go do that.
Okie doke. Thank you.
Take care.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
All right, that was S.G. Goodman on Walking the Floor. Make sure to go give her debut record a spin. It's called Old Time Feeling, and it's great. All right, boys and girls, enjoy these crazy wild times we are living in while they last, and we will see you in like a week, I'm thinking. I don't know what my next episode's going to be, but it's going to be fantastic, as always, on Walking the Floor. Okay, kids. Adios, amigos!